The lecture this afternoon will be given by Professor Hugh Montgomery. Hugh obtained a first-class BSc in cardiorespiratory physiology and neuropharmacology in 1984, before graduating from the Middlesex Hospital Medical School in 1987. He obtained his higher research degree from the University of London. Was that 1987? Yes. He is accredited in general internal medicine, cardiology, and intensive care medicine, and is now professor of intensive care medicine at UCL, where he directs the UCL Center for Human Health and Performance. He described the first gene for human fitness and has since published over 300 scientific papers, two of which are in Nature. Hugh, a warm welcome. And once again, thanks for taking the time out of your busy schedule to deliver this lecture for us this afternoon. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed for the invitation to speak. And I was saying to Liz earlier on, it's quite fun to be given a topic about which one hasn't spoken before, because it makes one think a little. So what I've tried to do is pull together two strands, one really on Western healthcare, one on more global health issues, both of which I have an interest in. And I guess I'm the turkey voting for Christmas in some respects, because I work at the technological end of medicine in research and also in clinical practice. So maybe I should be changing. This is the general feeling of Western healthcare. I'm sure that in Ireland you have a view that may be less happy of your health system, just as we do in Great Britain when we look at our rather creaking and groaning healthcare system. But by and large, when we compare ourselves to other countries, we're pretty glad with what we've got. And certainly I put the UK here. We trumpet the NHS. Of course, you won't hear anyone wanting to threaten that in the coming general election. And the why is pretty good. This pretty intensive survey of ranking Western healthcare systems, and they're ranked between 1 and 11. And if you look at the UK column there, you'll see that it ranks number one in pretty much everything. And that's a reason for celebration. Until you start taking a little look at what it's being measured, what are the quality measures? And they're over there. Safe care, well, that's good. Not hurting people sounds like a good plan. That's scarcely making them better. Coordinated care, well, we'd all like that, but that's not the same as making a difference. Patient-centered care, well, that could mean anything, couldn't it? As long as it's patient-centered, it doesn't have to be good. Cost-relatedness of issues and problems, timeliness of care, all very good, but they're not actually telling you anything about health. And there are some nasty bits in there if you look more closely, like that one down there. We rank 10th out of 11th on what I would consider the most important metric, healthy lives. This is a national health service, and we're ranking pretty appallingly badly. And bear in mind that the UK and these countries here are vastly better than most healthcare systems in the world. So I would contend on that basis, the national health service that we have, and I would guess a health service you have in Ireland, is not a health service. It's a disease service. Its metric is to see and treat more, and the more illness there is that it treats, the better it's doing its job. And that's a perverse incentive. Because treating disease isn't a good way of maintaining health. It consumes enormous amounts of resource in propping up a system that's collapsing. So I've given you some examples here. And I've deliberately cherry-picked. Of course, it's not to say that Western medicine's rubbish at everything. It's spectacularly good at quite a lot of things. But if we look at some of the really spangly technological ends, look what we're doing. This is neonatal intensive care with very small prems born at 23 or 24 weeks of gestation. No matter what you do with those children, and you stick them on your neonatal intensive care unit, half of those born at 23 weeks will die. And that's not a lovely romantic death wrapped up in a little woolen blanket being held by mum and dad. That's after being stuck on a ventilator with all sorts of things being done to you when you're about that big, until you die. And a third of those born at 24 weeks will die. The care was futile. And again, it's not to say they're born and die, they're suffering along the way. It's very expensive. Neonatal intensive care beds cost a lot of money, and it goes on for a long, long time. And once they get through, they have substantial disability, which adds to cost, £250,000 sterling per year of childhood life for those that survive. And again, look at the suffering involved too. There are a large number of those children that do survive who get through with mild to moderate disability, but a third of those born at 23 weeks suffer very severe disability. And my wife, who's a paediatric intensivist, tells me that paediatric intensive cares are now filling up with the consequences of this sort of management. Of children very much loved, I'm not going to argue that's not the case, very much loved, but with children who cycle backwards and forwards from home to intensive care. Cancer. Well, quite a lot of us are going to get it. Quite a lot of it's curable. Many people live with cancer. But there's a lot of futility and expense in some cases as well. Of the 21 anti-cancer therapies approved by the FDA in the USA up till 2014, these were costing around $100,000 a year, between $100,000 and $120,000 a year, with a median improvement in life expectancy of 2.1 months. 2.1 months for treatment costing $120,000 per person. And if you look at cancer care overall in the European Union, in 2009 alone, the total expenditure on cancer care and in lost earnings related to cancer was over 126 billion euros. That was more than the entire EU budget that year. And of course, in this treatment, there's a lot of suffering. You and I in this room will all know people that have had chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and if it saves your life, we'd probably all have it, but not many of us would choose to have it if it was avoidable. So what about my job? Intensive care. I work on adult intensive care. Well, currently it's around a fifth of our emergency admissions to intensive care will die. And again, to remind you, it's not they hit the ITU and die within hours. These people usually are there for a very, very long time before they suffer and die. It's costing us in the UK around 1.6 billion euros a year. And the consequences on the intensive care unit are savage. Delirium, really unpleasant delirium. If you look up David Aronovich's account, the journalist, of his time on intensive care, he describes very common sorts of hallucinations. They're normally deeply unpleasant. They involve being tortured, being wheeled into scanners as incinerators or crematoria, thinking that you're being turned into a zombie. We regularly have patients coming back to the intensive care to try to convince themselves that those things weren't real. So vivid were they. About 6 in 10 are still suffering significant depressive illness 5 years after we discharged them. Upwards of 60% of adults of working age still aren't working several years after discharge. And post-traumatic stress is common. So we're killing a lot of people, not killing a lot of people, a lot of people aren't surviving. And those that are surviving are facing a pretty torrid time to get there. And this is the way we're going now. The hospitals are filling up with people who are becoming more and more dependent on the technologies that we are providing. And this quote comes from a New England Journal article from a few years ago. We're creating an expanding population of hospital-dependent patients with progressive functional decline to death. And even 12 years ago, 13, 14 years ago, one in five Americans who died did so shortly after or on an intensive care admission. Now you might say, well, who cares? Bunch of people die, don't make it, load of people suffer along the way. Quite a lot of the people who suffer along the way are still grateful that they're still alive at the end of it. So stop whinging, do your job. The trouble is we can't afford to do this anymore. And that's in the UK, but it's to West, every single Western healthcare system is facing exactly the same problems of this perfect storm. An inverted demographic pyramid of more and more old people who, because of good healthcare earlier on in their lives, are now living to be much, much older. When I was a medical registrar in 1990, if you were 65, you went to the geriatrics team and you could not have dialysis in Great Britain. 65. I don't know about you over here, but my wards are full of people in their 80s now. those patients have all got more and more disease states all interacting with each other, and so it's not additive but synergistic in terms of the complexity of their disease pathway managements. Each of those disease states on their own for investigation and management costs a lot of money, and even the boring ones like my L5S1 disc and a few other things generally add substantial cost to our society. We've got more and more people then with more and more stuff, and we can do more and more. There are more drugs, more technologies that we can apply, all of which cost, and the public are expecting more. Certainly where I work, the days were 30 years ago when I could say to a family, I'm very sorry that your mum's dying, so we'll tuck her up in bed and you can hold her hand. I wouldn't manage that in nearly any case now. People's expectations are that you will flog their mother to the point of death, because somehow that's what they might want. And our economies, if you haven't noticed, are tanking. So this is striking us. If it's not striking you in Ireland, it will soon. We used to have an increase around 3.7% in our budget a year. We're now spending less than 1% per year rise. In fact, given the expanding population of older people, we were, until last year, having a rise of only 0.1% in expenditure per capita per year. And that was meant to cope with that increasing complexity and that new technology and those increasing expectations. We now know we're in a deficit. We're spending less per capita, but people want more. And I've given you the data up to 2015 and 16, but basically, if you don't want to read all of these, it just says that the United Kingdom's health service is bust. Everyone's in debt. So the acute trust in which I work with its hospital, nearly 100% of those are now running a deficit. My intensive care unit, for instance, last year was overspent by £1.1 million sterling, and we can't do anything about that to save money. We've trimmed the efficiency as best we can. So that's my first premise. A lot of what we're doing, with the best intentions in the world, can be futile. A lot of that futility involves enormous suffering, and a lot of that suffering comes at huge fiscal expense, and we can't afford it anymore. That's not sustainable. And if it's not sustainable, we've got to do two things. Either we've got to find a way to make it sustainable, or we've got to park up and stop doing it, or there's going to be a car crash. Now, of course, the nonsense is that most of what we're treating, or an awful lot of what we're treating, is entirely preventable. We didn't have to have those diseases in the first place. So here are the 2013, oddly enough, the most recent data I can find, ranking global burden of disease in English regions in Great Britain. So number one is ischemic heart disease. In number two is lung cancer. Then we've got cerebrovascular disease, COPD, working our way through Alzheimer's, and running down to leukemias and things at the bottom end. Have a quick look down that list and work out which of those you think has a preponderant environmental driver to it. Now, you're probably a very well-educated audience, so if I was to show this to a lay audience, they wouldn't understand that colorectal cancer or breast cancer were environmental diseases. You probably do. The same with stomach cancer. They wouldn't know about nitrates in food and alcohol and so forth. But let's look at some of the common drivers. Smoking, poor diets, too much alcohol, drug use or misuse, and environmental pollution. Smoking drives all of those diseases. Dietary factors are drivers for all of those, and you'll see there's quite a lot of overlap. Excess alcohol consumption drives those. Drug misuse drives those. And environmental pollution drives those. Look at that clustering of where those arrows all converge in the top 10 to 12 items. A lot of those diseases at the top don't need to happen at all. In the numbers, there will always be cases, but we're driving large numbers of those cases. As an example, sure that Ireland's the same as Great Britain, I remember my first visit to North America to lecture, and I made the mistake of visiting a theme park because it was nearby and I bunked off the conference. And I couldn't look at any of the rides or things there because I was just gobsmacked at seeing people as fat as they were. I'd never seen people of 60 stone before. Now I see that sort of thing all the time. 24% in England of patients are obese, or the public are obese adults, and 36% overweight. That's over half of our population now, with a condition that drives osteoarthritis, breast cancer, bowel cancer, depression, coronary artery disease, strokes, high blood pressure, diabetes, etc., just as one exemplar. So in overall, in my practice, or in Great Britain's practice, about 40% of the disease we see have preventable factors driving them. So I was talking to my son about this the weekend, my eldest son, because I was busy beavering away on a bank holiday writing some more slides, and we were talking about the options. If you want nice clean bath water and there's sewage running out of the taps, you've got a few options. The obvious one, as he pointed out, would be to get out of the bath, which is probably the best answer. But the first thing you can do is you could just open the taps full and then buy a bunch of expensive pumps to try to put more clean water into your bath and pump it out quicker than the rate the sewage was going in. That's the current health system. You could say, well, some people are just going to have to live in baths full of sewage and put up with it, and if you're rich enough, you can buy better plumbing. I don't think many of us would want to go back to those days. Most of us at least have a little bit of socialist left in us. You could try educating people that sewage was bad, but that doesn't help you if you're poor and you can't afford the better plumbing. Or you could just find a way of stopping the sewage getting in your bath in the first place. And it seems to me that whilst we are increasingly going for option one, we should be looking at option four. So the big question then is, how do you shut off the sewage sources? How do we stop these diseases? And it may come as a surprise to you to hear as sort of someone who does molecular biology research and intensive care, for me to start saying it's about social systems. And the key of those is poverty. Let's look at life expectancy in years, England and Wales. It's on the y-axis going up to about 79 years. And those are just 30 or so neighborhoods plotted on the x-axis by how wealthy they are per capita income. And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to see the very, very strong association between poverty and living a shorter life. That's not genetic, that's environmental. Again, looking at the neighborhood deprivation indices on the x-axis at the bottom, the richest again are to your right, the poorest are to your left, and the top is life expectancy, and the bottom is disability-free life expectancy. How many years you can live before something gets in there and stops you being able to function in the way that you would otherwise like. 10-year difference in life expectancy, 20-year difference in disability-free life expectancy. One of the many reasons that this idea that we can push back the pensionable age ever further and ever older to save money won't work in a society where there are large numbers of poor people, because you will move people from a pension to disability benefit. And this is incredibly wasteful, even if you don't care about poor people suffering. 2.5 million years, life years lost each year among the poor. 33 billion lost in productivity because these people could work were they not significantly disabled by ill health. 32 billion lost in taxes and added benefit costs. And a huge bill to our health service of £5 billion a year. So if you could work out what those drivers of ill health were in poverty, there's a pretty big gain to be made from it. And there is a lot of suffering involved. This, again, is looking at the richest to the right, the poorest to the left. And we're looking at environmental conditions that you and I might take to be good to have around us. So good river quality, rivers nearby, green space, good air quality, biodiversity, low risk of your house getting flooded, litter, detritus, poor housing conditions, high areas of accidents and road traffic accidents, and areas where you've got landfill sites next to your house. Well, look at the number of people who've got one, two, or three or more of those conditions. It's the poor areas that are the least pleasant to live in. We all know that. It's certainly true of all the cities I've lived in. The rich people are the ones that get to live in the really nice places. The poor people live in really crummy places. And that does affect their physical health, but it affects their mental health. Just one statistic. Look at the difference in the frequency of postnatal depression by socioeconomic status. It's not to say that postnatal depression is a disease of the poor, but if you are poor, you are very much more likely to get it. If you're the poorest end of the spectrum, a quarter of mums will suffer it. What does that do to the child? What does that do to the other children? What does that do to the partner? So my first, well, I suppose my second contention, firstly, that we're getting it wrong in the way we do things, but secondly, we do have to move away from spangly medicines to start thinking about old-fashioned social issues like poverty. So being poor is bad, all right? So we've probably all seen these sorts of graphs before. This is looking at national income per dollar. I think these were 1995 adjusted dollars as well. And we're looking at life expectancy. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to realize that if you're poor, your life expectancy tends to be a bit lower. And if you're richer, you tend to be up in the top right-hand corner. That's how this graph is normally explained. But let's have another look. Let's have a look at that block there. Okay. In the top left, you've got Montenegro and Albania. Pretty much as poor as any country in the world. But almost the same life expectancy as the richest countries in the world. Why is that? Why can you be as poor as that, as poor as pretty much any country in the world, but have the same life expectancy as some of the richest? Why is it that Swaziland, which is the one that's down there to the right, can be bordering on, you know, $10,000 per capita per year and have a life expectancy 30 or more years less than Montenegro, where people are earning a third of that per capita? So to expand on that, if you look at the Western country blocks, the ones that tend to be in that top arc, you see the same complete dissociation between wealth and life expectancy. It's a scattergun, isn't it? In fact, the USA is down the bottom right, and Israel's up there a little bit higher up the list. No relationship. And you see the same for health and social problems. So if we look at this compounded index of life expectancies, maths, literacy, infant mortality, homicide, imprisonment, teenage births, distrust, obesity, mental illness, addiction, social mobility, and score that, you find again, money doesn't make you happier, doesn't very obviously seem to make you less happy, although I suppose if you took the USA out and did a bit of cheating, you could draw a regression line that said money don't buy you happiness, son. So what is the difference? Well, one of the differences is probably inequity. It's staggering to me, if you look at the Oxfam and WHO report from last year, that the richest 62 people in the world now own as much wealth as nearly 4 billion of the poorest. That's the population of Africa, of India, and the whole of China, if they were all the poorest, having the same wealth as slightly less than one 64-seater coach of people. That's the disparity of wealth in the world now. And you'll find that in every country, and this disparity, without boring you with it, is widening. Ireland, for Western countries, is pretty much in the middle, that's you. The richest people on average are around 6 times richer than the poorest people. If you go up to Singapore, it's 10 times the difference. But either way, these gaps are increasingly widening, partly related to the way businesses now operate. So let's plot disparity, iniquity of income per capita, and see what difference that makes. That's where we were before, index of health and social problems related per capita, there's nothing there. That's the relationship between income inequality. It's pretty solid. And it applies to mental illness. It implies going to prison. It applies to pretty much every index of child well-being. And you can do this for countries, between countries. You can do it between regions in countries. You can do it between cities in countries. You can do it in boroughs and councils in one city, and you'll find the same relationships. Where there is inequity, social structures seem to break down, and with it, health. Not enough, it seems to apply even between countries in high social class or a higher value income for households. So if you're counting, this is just England and Wales versus Sweden, Sweden being a very equitable country, England and Wales not being, we're worse, as you saw there, than Ireland is. The disparity is worse when you're looking at lower incomes, but it's still there for higher incomes. So to summarize what I've said so far, treating disease can be very expensive, it can be futile, it can be associated with a lot of suffering, and therefore I think cruelty. Much of what we treat actually is preventable. A lot of what we treat is preventable. And a lot of it's preventable or treatable not through the spangly end of medicine, i.e. disease treatment, but through changes in social policy that traditionally, certainly in Great Britain, don't fall under the realm of health. Our health budget is not the same as that that regulates air quality, transport, financial incentives in the food industry and agriculture, etc. Let me keep an eye on time to make sure I'm not going to keep you all here till 5 o'clock this afternoon. I promise I won't. Good. Because I'm going to move on to issues of global health. But I guess I'd finish that first section by saying that we do need a difference in leadership from all of you in the room and from people like me as well, because we're all pretty good at leading in the fields in which we're expert, I think. That's probably why you're all here, is you'll want to make a difference in the thing that you do. But sometimes it's perhaps important for us to step outside and work out whether what we're actually doing is the right thing in the first place. And if it's the wrong thing, maybe we should be trying to do what we do differently, lead our professions or our constituencies in a different direction. And I've certainly reached that feeling in my life that I probably can't continue to do what I do in the way that I do it and lead people down that path because I no longer think it's the right path. We also need leaders in other spheres. I'm going to take you now to a totally different realm, and that of really big ticket stuff. So if you thought that your national economy and health were big, we're going to go much bigger. I'm going to talk about global health. And I'm going to take you on a bit of a historical journey. Multicell life on Earth appeared around 540 odd million years ago. The human species polled up somewhere around 160 odd thousand years ago, probably, if you look at the mitochondrial DNA. 70,000 years ago, there were probably around 5,000 breeding pairs of humans on the planet, so there weren't very many of us. And even if you go back 2,000 years ago, there were substantially less than 500 million people on the planet, the entire planet. And not much changed for quite a long time as we move forward in this century, until we hit the agricultural revolution, and then we hit the industrial revolution. The agricultural revolution, meaning that we could suddenly start growing crops on a more commercial scale, and the industrial revolution kick-starting that into really massive production. And of course, a lot went with the industrial revolution too, but to start with, it was about food delivery. So, after 540 million years of multicelled life, 160,000 years of humanity, we reached our first billion people, probably somewhere around 1804. And it took another 123 years for us to stick another billion people on the planet. Only 123, though, it's pretty good going compared to 160,000. Then only took us 33 years to add another billion, 14 to add the next, and essentially we've been adding another billion every 12 to 14 years ever since. 4 years later, 2016, we bust the 7.5 billion mark on the planet. We're now rapidly heading towards 8 billion people. This is a colossal rate of change. But let's look at the GDP, world domestic product. And that's on the y-axis on the right. And you'll see that it's done the same sort of thing. A very, very, very sharp inflection point in the 1900s. Well, the world economy in 1990 dollars absolutely kicked off to well over 80 trillion US dollars now. Then look at that per capita, and you'll see there's a dissociation. The number of people's gone up incredibly steeply, but the amount of money each one of those people on the planet is spending has gone up even more. So per capita, 1990 dollars. In 1880 was around $600. In the year 2000, around 6,000. 2012 was around 11,000 US dollars. And you might say, well, what's his point here? My point is that those dollars are underpinned by resources. They're not underpinned by a gold reserve anymore, but they all, those transactions all involve the use of something. And ultimately, it's a use of resource, whether it's phosphate or water or uranium or lead or tin or gold or any other natural resource you might think of, or soil, for instance. That huge inflection that we've seen there, this massive ramp up, means that we're using environmental resources in the same sort of way. And I could talk all afternoon about that. I won't. I will just show you a few exemplars because they're good and they're visual. You'd like to think that water, when I was at school, we all learn about the water cycle. So you can't run out of water. Basically, you take it out of a river and you spray it on your crops, or it rains on the crops, and whatever that is, runs down into an aquifer, and you might pump it out and reuse it, or it goes into the sea where it evaporates again, and then it rains again, and that's where you get your water. Turns out it isn't where we get a lot of our water for agriculture. A lot of our water for agriculture comes from sealed fossil systems more than 10 million years old. When you drain them dry, they're gone. A lot of other water comes from groundwater, which you just pump out of the water that's working its way through to deeper systems, and when you've used that up, it's gone as well, because it takes ages for it to refill. And we're doing this all around the world. This is the Aral Sea on the Kazakh-Uzbek border. In 1989, a little over 170,000 square kilometers. That's the satellite imagery from 1989. That's 2014. You can see that again if you want to. Okay, 20 odd years. That's Lake Chad in 1977. Going through 1998 to 2010, it does this. And I could show you the pictures of Lake Urmia in Iran or any number of other places that are utterly decimated. Lake Urmia is now a massive salt pan where wildlife just dies if it can get anywhere near any water that's left. And this is happening all over the world, and a lot of agriculture is dependent on it. The Ogallala Aquifer subtends the grain production in the United States for eight states, and when that's drained dry, there won't be water left. On the North China Plain, the aquifer that subtends the crops there, when that goes dry, their wheat production for 640 million people will stop. Half a billion people will go without wheat. To do this sort of agricultural work, and using all that water, we need a lot of land. And when you till soil, it doesn't matter if it's with a horse and a plough, or whether it's with something that's mechanized. Just breaking up the particles on the surface causes around 1% of it to blow away. And there's nothing you can do about that. That would happen even if you were to dig it in your own garden. But it does mean that because agriculture is so intensive, that we're losing around 10 kilograms of topsoil for every meal that every single person eats in the Western world. Three meals today, 30 kilograms of topsoil for every single one of you, and me included. And there's a real threat that we are going to run out of topsoil. Topsoil takes thousands of years to come back if you've got organic material on it. So there's a serious risk put by many within 50 or 60 years that we won't be able to grow food on any of the land which we're currently growing food. And those sorts of drivers, huge numbers of people all wanting to eat more, all wanting more and more crops, loss of areas now becoming infertile, lack of water is a big driver for deforestation. It's why we're chopping rainforests down at this sort of rate and why we've lost over 50% of the broadleaf forests in the world already. And I could spend all afternoon doing this, but you get my point. This massive removal and destruction of environmental habitats and use of resources, and I haven't talked about the pollutants and so forth we're putting back into the system, is destroying and disrupting ecosystems in a way that's destroying life on the planet. And if you're really interested, it's worth looking at the 2014 and 2016 World Wildlife Fund Zoological Society and Zoological Society of London reports, the Living Planet Index. This is looking at multicell vertebrates. All right. Now, looking around the audience, most of you are a lot younger than I am. But I was 8 in 1970. I was born in 1962. So since I was 8 years old, and I'm now 54, we've destroyed half the vertebrates on the planet in terms of numbers have gone. And this rate isn't declining. Worse still is the number of species that are becoming extinct. It's now about 8 an hour. And according to the United Nations Environment Programme, that's the fastest mass extinction the planet has ever seen. And you're living through it right now. It's around 10,000 times quicker than any mass extinction in the fossil record. Now, that rate of decline in numbers of species is not falling away, and the extinction rates are not diminishing. They're accelerating. They're accelerating. And if we've lost half of the vertebrate bodies on the planet since I was 8, and I'm now 54, that number's increasing ever more quickly, as are the number of extinctions. So humanity's balance on the top of this really fragile inverted pyramid ecosystem, and we're intent on hacking away at its base. And when that collapses, we will go with it. And finally, I'm just going to put to you that that may not be very far away, because my intensive care patients on adult ITU can sometimes be people like you, young, fit and healthy, and you get a sudden horrible insult that knocks you off your perch. But more often than not, it's the patients about which we spoke earlier who've accumulated a burden of disease. And then one more thing comes in, and it's that one big extra hit that finishes them. And that big hit, in our case, is climate change. It's the release of greenhouse gases that let shortwave radiation through and trap some degree of the energy from longwave radiation, causing the planet to warm around 1.6 watts of extra warming per square meter of the entire planet's surface now. This is what humanity burned in the way of fossil fuels last year. Okay. Bear in mind, 100 or so years ago, a lot of North American cities were still lit by whale oil. This has been a revolution in the times of your grandparents. The first commercial jet ticket was sold a little over 60 years ago. Last year, 98 people boarded a passenger jet a second in the world. And this applies to every aspect of our lives. And all that carbon dioxide that we're producing, and there are other greenhouse gases too, are going into a remarkably thin atmosphere. So if you were to take the entire world's atmosphere and roll it into a ball at standard temperature and pressure at sea level, that's the size of the ball. The world's atmosphere is very, very small. And in the days when I used to climb to high altitude, if I was, for instance, on an 8,000 meter peak in the Himalayas, 2/3 of the world's atmosphere was already below me. At 8 kilometres, that's 5 miles. Half the world's atmosphere is below you at 3 miles. And most of us wouldn't think twice about walking 3 miles. So if you put huge quantities of gas into a very small volume, very quickly, guess what? The concentration goes up. So this is going back the last 10,000 years, and you can look at the speed of change of those greenhouse gas concentrations. It's absolutely catastrophic. And this stuff doesn't go away very quickly. So around a fifth of the greenhouse gases we put in the atmosphere now, from the lights we've got on here, the computer that I'm using, will still be warming the atmosphere in 33,000 years from now. 7% of this will be warming our atmosphere in 100,000 years, still warming our planet. You are now breathing the highest CO2 concentration that any human being has ever breathed before. And that's independent of the ventilation in this particular room, which is actually quite good. Just atmospherically outside, this is new. I say that's causing us to gain around 1.6 watts per square meter. Doesn't sound very much, does it? But I don't know, you're probably better at estimating than I am. If we call this room, I don't know, 10 meters by 20, 200 square meters maybe, that's around 300 watts. And imagine a 300 watt radiator blasting the heat out and that heat not going anywhere, being trapped in the atmosphere, and that applying to this room all around the Earth's surface. Hard to get your head around it unless we convert it into an energy that's a bit more easy to get, which is Hiroshima bombs. We're gaining around 5 Hiroshima bombs of energy a second in our atmosphere. And it's energy in atmospheres that causes weather. So if you have more energy in your atmospheric system, you will get more weather. You'll get higher temperatures. Anyone who's bothered to measure them knows the temperatures are going up. You could say, okay, I'm not interested in the temperatures, but you would expect, even if you were my 11 or 14 year old, that ice would melt more. That's polar cap in 1980. That's 2012. And still thinning at this sort of rate and accelerating. You've probably seen the data being very widely reported from earlier this year. And sea levels are rising, and they're also rising at increasing rates. And any other metric you want of more energy in the system, it's there. And this matters to human health. Warmer places, bacteria grow quicker. It's why you get a dodgy tummy more commonly in a warm climate, and the salmonella grows more in your chicken. You get more ocean and river algal blooms, which are toxic. You get big changes in vector-borne diseases, so the snails for schistosomiasis, mosquitoes for malaria and dengue and so forth. You get big changes in aeroallergens, so pollen seasons start earlier, pollen densities are greater, pollen allergenicity rises. And you get rises in ground level ozone when temperatures go up as a natural pollutant, which isn't good for your health either. But most of those you'll look at and go, well, I'm not really that worried about this. You know, global warming is not too much of a problem to me. The problem will hit you is because the extreme weather. If you keep putting 5 Hiroshima bombs of energy a second into your atmospheric system, you will get more weather. And extreme weather events, whether it's rainfalls, droughts, strong winds, are becoming increasingly frequent worldwide. And that's just a natural function of this. It's physics. It's what you'd expect. But to give you the examples of what that can do, this was 2010, the warmest ever recorded up till that point. We've been hotter since, of course. Big heat wave affecting 2 million square kilometres of Europe, centred particularly around Moscow. Huge fires, very expensive, led to a Russian famine in a state of emergency, and importantly, as we'll come to in a minute, led to Kazakhstan becoming a net importer of grain, when normally it's an exporter. The same year, this was Pakistan, when a fifth of its entire land surface area was underwater. Huge numbers of people affected and their health decimated. I was going to put an old bunch of slides giving you list after list after list after list after list of all the extreme weather events in the last 10 years and their escalating numbers, but you read the papers, you see it as well as I do, and I'm sure that the weather in Ireland is the same as we have in England. It's increasingly unstable and erratic. Again, you might say, well, we've got solid buildings, I don't live on a floodplain, I'm away from the Liffey and it's not going to flood my house, and my house is made of stone, it won't blow over, and you know, having a few warmer summers won't matter too much, and I don't even mind a bit more rain because I'm used to it. It will matter to you. This was what happened when the Russian heatwave hit in the summer of 2010 to grain prices, which were around $150 a metric ton. By a year later, they were $350 a metric ton. Now, you might not have noticed, because people that want to send you bread and stuff made of wheat absorbed quite a lot of that cost rise for you, because they want you in a supermarket to buy toilet cleaner, red wine and DVDs. Bread and milk are a way of getting you in. But if you were in a poor country where you had to meet that price to get your daily bread, you wouldn't be able to afford it. And when you couldn't afford it, and you were already pretty cheesed off with your government, you would take to the street. And where these grain prices went directly to the street, there was revolution. And that was the Arab Spring. And the Royal United Services Institute, the International Institute for Strategic Studies, and many others ascribed the Arab Spring to this event. It was a climate change event. Not to say there weren't security problems and deep political tensions, but the trigger was this. So climate change brings wars. You might think the Americans have been there or have been sort of deniers for a very long time, but look at this report from 2003, made public some years ago now, from the Pentagon, acknowledging that humans were causing climate change. But don't you love the language about the consequences? The result could be a significant drop in the human carrying capacity of the Earth's environment. Think about what that means in terms of your lives, those of your children. Significant drop in the human carrying capacity of the Earth's environment. They're right, of course. So climate change is a matter for health, for your health, for those of your children and your grandchildren. For the reasons we've discussed, the effects of direct heat, direct injury, pollution, allergens, vector-borne diseases, drought, flood, crop failure, economic collapse, migration, and war. And it's for those reasons that the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society, as long ago as 2011, said that if we were on the path to a 4-degree temperature rise globally, that this was incompatible with an organized global community, that we wouldn't be able to adapt to it. It would devastate our ecosystems, which I'll remind you are already devastated, and is a transition point to a very much higher temperature. So that's the end of civilization as you know it, and your health system won't be able to do anything about that. Yet again, we're ignoring the causes of the disease and seeing if we can't just treat the consequences, and we can't. So finally, and I'm going to stop in a moment because you probably want to go and slash your wrists or something in a minute, but the question is what we do. Well, the issue is that this is all fixable. So just as we described earlier on with the problems that drive illness relating to inequity, which we can address through social change, that relate to policy from transport and energy and housing, and cigarettes, and alcohol, and drugs, and transport. All of those things are readily fixable by any government of any colour that has the will to do it. And so too for climate change. So I co-chaired with Tony Costello this commission. He's now the Director of Women and Children's Health for the WHO, and we published it in June 2015. If you want to read the executive summary, if you don't want to read the whole thing, it is free on the net if you log into the Lancet, you can read it for nothing. The first commission we put out in 2009 made the case that this was a major threat to health. This commission was saying, well, is it fixable? And unusually for a doctor, we didn't include many doctors in the commission. We included economists and engineers and political scientists. And we said, is there a way of fixing it? And that was the conclusion. So we said to the economists, enough money to sort this problem? They said, yeah, loads of cash, no problem, loads of money, so much money, no one even knows where to put it because you can't get the interest rates anymore. Lots of money looking for a place to invest, no shortage. So he went to the technologist and said, if you had the money, could you fix it? They said, yeah, we could fix it tomorrow. How much? A little over $1 trillion a year of world GDP, which is over $80 trillion a year now. So just a little over 1% of world GDP would solve the problem tomorrow morning. Why isn't it being solved? Because there isn't a political driver for it to happen. So there you are, $1 trillion a year, a little over 1% of world GDP, a little under a fifth of what we already spend on healthcare globally anyway in the world, and a very small fraction of what we already spend on maintaining current fossil fuel-based energy systems. So it's not much. And the good news out of that trillion is that an awful lot of what you would do to fix that happens to be very healthy, even if there were no such thing as climate change. So by way of exemplar, if we changed urban planning and policy to make it expensive and difficult to drive, and easy and pleasant to walk and cycle with your kids to school, less particulate pollution, everywhere from PM10s to the ultrafine particles drops, and with that the rates of COPD, stroke, probably neurodegenerative dysfunction as well, asthma and so forth. A coal-fired power station shut in Poland a couple of years ago, and there was an over 50% reduction within weeks in acute admissions for respiratory disease in nearby hospitals. Very quick gearing just by not chucking out pollutants. But when people are active, they get less obesity, diabetes, stroke, coronary disease, peripheral vascular disease, bowel cancer, breast cancer, depression, osteoporosis. If everyone in London cycled the same distance that people in Copenhagen cycle, which is only about a couple of miles a day, we'd get rid of about 1 in 5 cases of breast cancer. Additionally, value, of course, we get rid of the greenhouse gases, which just happens to be really good for addressing climate change. Red meat, cows. People think it's about cows farting methane, that is part of the issue, but most of it's belching. They're ruminants, so they ferment the cellulose and they belch a lot of methane, and they're big contributors to greenhouse gases. And to get the increasing amounts of red meat everyone wants to eat, we're chopping down rainforests to grow crops to feed to the cattle and for the cattle to graze on. So if we stop eating red meat, or dramatically cut down, we address the climate change issue. But as a white male, which I own up to being, that's the likeliest thing now to get me at my age in Great Britain is bowel cancer. And the commonest single driver for that outside alcohol consumption, ahead of that, is red meat consumption. So that's pretty good. Saturated fat consumption is also related, as you know, to breast cancer, as well as to coronary disease and stroke. So it just so happens that these things that are actually very good for the planet are really good for us, and we can address both problems about which I've been speaking today in one go. And it saves a lot of money, a lot of money. If we were to go to these low carbon solutions, reduce our greenhouse gas emissions by 30% in the EU, by 2030 we'd be saving us around 38 billion in healthcare costs related to that every year. And we get back around a quarter of the $1 trillion we would spend on decarbonising, we'd get back almost immediately in healthcare gains. So when I put this to you, it seems a bit crazy to do what we're currently doing. We need medical leadership, and by medical, that's not meant to be doctor-centric. I mean health worker leadership. And that health worker can be an unqualified mum or dad looking after their baby. They're involved in looking after the health of their children. It can be a nurse or a midwife or a doctor or a social worker or a physiotherapist. But those of us that would like to think that our main drivers are beneficent, to try to make the world a better place, to try to let people live healthier lives that are longer and that are happier, if that's what's driving us, and I hope that it is for most of us in this room, what are we doing in just patching things up? We're getting our emotional fix, I would argue, by immediate reward, feeling good about what we did today by immediately helping people, when actually maybe we should be looking at what we can do to stop them getting ill in the first place. We should be social reformers, all of us, demanding social and economic change, not just arguing for more spangly technology. Finally though, and I think it is finally, almost finally. I'm not a complete Luddite. I'm not saying smash the machines completely, stop doing technology, because technology can help. But we've got to start doing it differently. I did declare an interest. I consult for an artificial intelligence company a day a week. That's DeepMind Health. But this is not a DeepMind plug. This is just to say we've all done as much efficiency as we can. I bet you've all had that mantra. You've got to do what you do more efficiently. You've done that. There's nothing you can do left that can be more efficient. Some of these technologies like AI will transform that for you. They will make diagnoses quicker and better and more accurately. They will identify who is not going to benefit from a treatment better. They will identify who's going to get sick before they get sick so we can take preemptive action. So there are technologies that can help us. But what we've got to do if we get a cash dividend from this sort of behaviour is not spend it on more technology to treat more disease. We've got to spend it, in my view, on the social and economic architecture that lets people live happier and healthier lives in the first place. And finally, I think that is the last slide. Yeah, I don't know how we do this. That's probably an issue for you. You're the leadership people in this audience. I'm still trying to work out how to lead there. Britain, I have no idea who represents me anymore politically. I don't think any of the parties really do. And if I could identify who they were, I wouldn't know who to go and talk to. And if I could go and talk to those people, I dare say they wouldn't take any notice of what I had to say. So I'm disenfranchised, but then so is everyone in Western Europe, which is why everyone's voting with bricks, and it's why Trump presumably got in. There is a general dissatisfaction which you may share with me in not knowing how to change things. So if we're on a slippery road and it's hard to know where to gain traction, maybe what we have to do is just start doing things differently ourselves, getting together and making demands for a different sort of society. And I don't know how we're going to do that outside the conventional political structures. And I'm open to suggestions. But at that point, I will stop. I would also say that you do not have to be polite. If you've been here for an hour, and I'm sure you've got things to do, so if you have, don't feel embarrassed about getting up and legging it to the doors. But if you have got some questions, I'll gladly take them. Thanks very much for listening. Right, except that I think we oversell what we can do. To quote the Verve's album title from many years ago, the drugs don't work. A lot of the time, what we give to people just doesn't work. So you know, for instance, the stuff about codeine, 7% of people don't get any benefit at all because they haven't got the right genes for it. So there's a whole bunch of people that are getting no benefit, a lot of people are getting lots of side effects, and we work on a mean where we bump people up a little bit. But drugs are not that effective for a large number of the diseases which we go to treat. And people, we're trying to move the conversation a lot earlier, because when the boat's going down, you want to think there's a life raft for you. And you'll clutch at anything. So the problem I often find myself facing is at 4 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday morning with a 92-year-old who now can't make a decision, and a family who don't want the guilt of letting mum die, who say, I want everything. And you say, do you really understand what everything actually is? Because it's not what you think it is. And I'm not a wizard and I don't have a big stick that will make everything better. So we've got to move the narrative much earlier. And that, I think, has to be done much more socially. So we're playing with some ideas. There's a very interesting director who I'd suggest you look up. He's got a YouTube channel that you can look up called Try Life. He came from a very impoverished background in Liverpool and was trying to work out how to change the social behaviours of people who seemed intent on self-destruction, and found that hitting them over the head with a stick as a healthcare worker was not going to be the answer. So he created interactive directed videos using non-professional actors where you can make a choice at each step about what you're going to do next, and he weights the odds of what the consequence of that will be. So it lets you play out Try Life, making different choices and seeing where it's likely to take you. So he has a 15-year-old or a 16-year-old about to do GCSEs, and she gets a phone call saying, why don't you come out for a party? We've all been working hard. And she gets a choice. Does she go to bed early or does she go to the party? Now, obviously, it's likely you sometimes weighted where you go to bed early and you wake up too stressed and you fail the exam because you should have gone to the party, but that's a much less likely outcome than going to the party where you then get a choice to drink or not to drink, and when you're drinking, to do the drugs or not to do the drugs, and then to have the unprotected sex or not, which does or does not lead you to the pregnancy or venereal disease. But it takes you, it lets you try out a bunch of consequences, not all end badly. It's not one of these things where it's preachy, because most of us have lived lives where we've got away with an awful lot that we probably shouldn't have done. But probabilities, it lets people try that out. And we're talking to them about the intensive care world as well, actually, to say, you know, it's not just a question of 80% survive, 20% don't, but let's look at the path of the 80%. Would you really want that? And then when you get out, would you really want that consequence? Because if you don't, now's the time to say. Respond by agreeing with you, and I probably was too imprecise in my language. So, do I think it's going to get fixed? In honesty, no, I don't. Do I think we've had it? In honesty, yes, I do. The only way that you've got any chance, in my view, of surviving anything bad, though, is by making an assumption that there might be a chance not to, because if one just throws one's hands up, then it is all over. You're quite right that the fixes to the environmental issues about which I spoke, and the collapse in ecosystems and loss of life and so forth, I can't see that that is amenable at all to a technical fix. And as you say, it's not as if we all just stop and we all carry on doing just what we're doing now, that things won't continue to get worse, because they will. It's the same with the climate change issue. If we all drop dead today, and even if our bodies didn't decompose, there's an awful lot of energy trapping gas in the system that's going to drive this juggernaut for an awful long time. The ice isn't going to stop melting tomorrow. It's not going to stop melting in 100 years. It's still going to be melting for all of that time. So in answer to your taking, I suppose, each of those, it is a bit simplistic. There is enough money on the climate change issue to deploy technologies that would work in stopping greenhouse gas emissions. But as you say, the challenge is how on earth you get that through a political system in the structures that we currently have. And I sort of see this as a tessellation. So if you just look in my country I know well, which of course is England, you've got a body politic who says, well, we don't want to mention that we've got to really do something about this greenhouse gas stuff, because no one's going to vote for that, right? It's a complete vote loser if we say we're going to radically change the way you live your lives. We're not going to let you have your 4x4s. We are going to tax things radically differently, etc. You will not have the life you thought you were going to have. Vote loser, which is why no one mentions it at all. The general public look at that and go, well, if it was that serious, the government would do something. I haven't got any choices from businesses in what I can do, so all I can do is live the life I can live anyway. So they are not driving the politicians or anyone else. The businesses are looking at the politicians saying, even if I believe this was an issue, for me to have a level playing field, the government would have to regulate, and they haven't. And the general public don't want it anyway. So we're stuck in this tessellation of inactivity. And then you can spread that around the world, where a company in Britain might say, well, okay, you could do it here and I would support you doing it here, but my rivals would just offshore straight away. And so I'd go bust, and the company in France or Germany or Korea would make the money. So they're paralyzed. And the government in Britain says, well, as we had in our previous chancellor, George Osborne, saying, well, we're gonna do any more than any other country is, because we don't want to disadvantage ourselves. So governments don't want to act because other governments won't act, and people feel disempowered. So I think you're right. I mean, it is technically fixable and it's financially fixable, but how you change the political structure, by which I don't just mean governments, I mean us, how do we all, I don't know what those levers are. I really don't. And so I share your despondency, if I'm honest. That is, I couldn't agree with you more. And I think we've swung I don't know, I can understand why we've done it, but when I was a medical student, I was at the tail end of the doctor or the midwife said it and you just did what you were told and you weren't involved in the conversation. I've been very clear with my colleagues, because I'm in my mid-50s and things are starting to go wrong with me, and I've told them that I don't want to be informed, because I would find, genuinely, I'm not making this sort of thing up. Emotionally, I find those sorts of things very difficult. So I've done my living will, it's clear to my family what I would and wouldn't accept. But I don't want my colleagues, if I get to 70, whatever it might be, and something bad, saying to me, you've blocked your inferior mesenteric artery, we could open you up and take the gut out, we could, you know, I want them to say, don't worry, mate, it's gonna be fine. That's what I want them to say to me, and they will know it, and they will. To say to a mother, my father was a pediatrician, and my wife is a pediatrician, so I declare an interest. My father used to be able to say, I'm so sorry, and be kind, and cuddle the mum and the dad, and let them hold their child, and go home with memories of the child dying with them. Now that there is an option, and they are given that option, what mother will find it easy to say no? It's really hard at that point. Is there such a thing as informed consent when you're in that sort of situation? Very, very hard to say. And it's tantamount to saying, do you actually love your child or not? And this is the problem I face with adults and their relatives. Because the question I ask is, would you like us, or would they want this doing? What they hear is, do you love your mum? And if the answer is, I love my mum, the answer they think they need to give is, stick them on the intensive care unit. Not, if you love your mum, you might just want to be kind to her. Very, very difficult. And I don't want it to appear that I'm being terribly patriarchal about this, that we should deny mothers any choice in what happens to their children. But these are conversations that shouldn't happen then. They're conversations that happen, as I had with my wife, before the conception. What are we going to do if we hit this? And I'm sure my wife wouldn't mind me telling you, she's a pediatric intensivist. We were very clear that we were not going to go down that technological route. I think that's very wise, and I do believe that those ground roots things probably are the way forward. I guess I intimated that I don't think it's any more that we go to a politician and make a demand and they vote for it for whatever, we just get on and do it. I think positive messages are always very good, but so is anger. And I had a conversation with a councillor in Britain, I better not be too precise because it got fairly heated, where this particular councillor was all in favour of basically access to 4x4s and driving and cyclists and pedestrians tough, and it was all about choice, although the choice oddly enough seemed to be only for the driver, not for anyone else. And I got onto the conversation of breast cancer and said, you know, you must know people with breast cancer, very common. Yes, he did, and he'd got her, you know, various family members. And I said, oh, must be pretty hard on you knowing that you're responsible for 1 in 5 of those cases. Because he is. It's his transport policy that's caused it. And we need to change that narrative a little bit for people saying, rather than the choice to drive my big car, where's the choice about not getting cancer, please? Where's the choice about walking with my kids safely and cycling along? It's almost psychic that you've made that, actually, because I've been giving similar thoughts to this for quite a while, and I'm reading a rather populist book. Let me dig it out for you, because I was reading it on the way here. But it is very well written, and he's gone for the great tabloid cover for a point, actually, to make a point. And it's called The Persuaders. Has anyone come across The Persuaders? Written by a philosopher. And it goes through the history of how we've been persuaded to adopt the tenets that you've described. At what point did we all start considering the world in the way that we currently do? And I'm only about halfway through, but the historical narrative is absolutely fascinating about how it came to be that people realized that the way that we all think could be controlled and the tools by which to do it. And actually a lot of it related to the war, when psychological operations first appeared and people got very adept at working out how to change a nation's mood, and a lot of those people came back and went straight into advertising and started using the same techniques and tools. It's quite fascinating. He makes the same point that you make about grassroots critical appraisal and community-based structure, because anyone in this room that's technologically literate will, and you're much more than I am because you're all younger than I am, so I'm sure that you're all blogging and not, I can't even say tweeting anymore because I know it's old hat, isn't it? It's all Instagram and God knows what now. But as we've seen in North America and Britain and now everywhere else, the news we're getting is often not the truth. What we get on our social media feeds is not what everyone else is getting. It's highly curated and manipulated using the bad sides of AI to steer us in the same way, surround us by people who think the same as us, give us the echo chambers that we all seem to want, which I avoid like the plague. I don't know about you, but when I buy music, I've got all those things switched off, the geniuses and things that are meant to say, well, if you like that, you'll really like this, because I don't want to buy the same bloody music. I want to have random music and find, oh, that's interesting, I never thought I'd like that. I don't want the same stuff. But if you're getting a news feed or a Twitter feed or a Facebook feed, what you're getting is not the same as what everyone else is getting, even if you all share the same friends. You're getting something that is steered to try to press your buzzers. And it's really dangerous, because the critical appraisal and evaluation is gone. You're no longer seeing the broad breadth of material, and it's no longer being weighed. And it's worse than that, because many journalists are using the internet and their stuff to even research their own stories. So I make a habit of reading a right-wing magazine, in my view, The Spectator, and what used to be a relatively left-wing magazine, The New Statesman, to try to make sure I get to hear at least two views. But if I didn't have that, I don't know what I would believe anymore. So you're right, we need critical appraisal, we need people to understand, to seek out the source of the information. So I totally agree. We all know the disparity between happiness and wealth, which is there. I mean, don't get me wrong, having open sewage running through your living room and stuff is miserable and horrible, and you know, poverty is not glamorous. But beyond a certain point, we know that it doesn't make people happier. So I take that point very well. The ethical and legal thing, we're all in the same echo chamber, obviously. So I pulled together a meeting in London 2 weeks ago on ethics and law for intensive care, which I have to say, I mean, I'd like to say it was me. It wasn't me. It was the audience and the speakers. But it was universally listed as the best education I've ever been to. It's the best education I've ever been to. And we invited the defense and prosecution lawyers to be speakers. And we had the doctors and the nurses in the audience. And we spent the briefest part of the day, if you want it, I'll send you the program, you can rerun it here. The briefest part just saying, what is the letter of the law? What's the case law? What's the things that you have to and have not to do? But now let's work our way through examples and cases. And you'd get the defense lawyer saying, yes, don't worry, I would defend you for that. You could absolutely make that decision. And you get the prosecution lawyer saying, you could try if you like, but I'm coming after you if you do that, because I know definitely I could drag you backwards through a hedge on that particular issue. The other thing that was amazing to us was that the lawyers had no idea at all. These were practicing medical legal lawyers. They had no idea at all about some elements of medical and nursing practice. And when they actually understood that some of these things were completely routine, they suddenly had to step back and they just didn't understand. So they're not bad people. It was just the first time we'd all tried to talk to each other again. So in fact, we're going to be inviting the lawyers to come and embed themselves in the hospital for a few weeks and see. It's true. I learned a lot from my father, who was very wise. I mean, he's died many, many years ago. But I remember him saying to me repeatedly when I was young, and you know, was off to do stupid things, and he said, you know, everything you do has a risk, and every intervention in medicine has a risk. So when I qualified, he was saying to me, always think before you do something, because everything you do, which may be well-intentioned, also carries a risk. And patients, like doctors, like anyone in the public, are very bad at understanding the difference and the relationship between risk and hazard. And I remember as a house officer being called to a cardiac arrest of a 32-year-old woman who hadn't even told her husband and children she was having an endoscopy. She'd had bad indigestion. The GP had said, we'll get you an endoscopy. She dropped the kids at school, thought she'd be in for a quick endoscopy, be home in time for tea, and no one would be any the wiser, and she didn't want to worry them. And the husband got the call saying, your wife's dead. Now, it's not common to die from a routine endoscopy, but it happens. And I do wonder if she had been told that, she may have said, well, the risk might be really, really remote, but the hazard is colossal. And so I don't think I'm going to have that. But we don't really let people think about it. And again, when you're ill, it's the wrong time to make the decisions, I think. We need to start these conversations so much earlier, don't we? But when do we have the time to do that? Now. We're all running around being too technology-driven, aren't we, to spend the time holding someone's hand and talking to them. Yeah, and I don't understand the biology of these things. I mean, I've looked at it fairly extensively, but why emotional distress and stress and lack of social congress makes you ill. But the data are really clear. I mean, if you look at Michael Marmot's work, in the Whitehall 1, Whitehall 2 studies, if you look at the people, for instance, who get sickest most commonly, it's the middle management. It's the people who are disempowered. So the boss at the top can say, make it so. And the person in the middle is powered to make it so, and ask the person below to make it so. The person below doesn't care. They go, I've got no skin in the game. It doesn't matter to me if it works or not. So the person in the middle is the one who gets really badly squeezed. And you see, it's not just they get more back pain, but they get more strokes and coronary disease and more cancer. You can see the same, these data are very clear, life events leading to illnesses that you would have thought were unrelated to matters of emotion and stress. But, marital breakup and moving house and a bunch of things, that you've seen these scoring data for years. You get past a certain trigger and it's highly likely you're going to get ill with something significant in the subsequent year. I suppose it's not witchcraft, is it? It's to do with the fact that catecholamines and stress hormones and corticosteroids, etc., are immunomodulators, and that they will change the way our biology works, and it makes us ill. But we have lost that to a degree, to a very substantial degree, I would agree. I was, we moved the children partly. My wife partly took a job out of London for that reason, to try to give them a sense of community, because in London, where we were, they didn't have it anymore. I probably have a Disney view of Ireland, right? So I fess up to that. I love Ireland. It's my favourite place in the world. And we were talking at lunchtime, and I come here with my family every summer. I have done forever, and I plan to until I can no longer move. My dad was from the north, actually, but I came to know the south from my trips there. So my Disney view of Ireland is that it is a country which could be done better than it could be done in the United Kingdom. I do genuinely get a feeling there is still more humanity here than there is in many other countries. That may be utter nonsense, but I think there is still a bit more soul, and it maybe has got time. And you do have more, as you say, more community. My younger sister's a nurse, works in a GP's practice, and it's absolutely colossal, and it's impossible. She doesn't get the chance to talk to people. And I'm sure your stories would be the same as mine. I was moved by my dean to a smaller North London District General Hospital to start an academic presence there, which actually didn't end up happening. So they were going to repatriate me, and I didn't want to go, because I find I've got it's not quite a community, but I do know all my nursing staff, the frequent flyers from the patients, I do know them very well, and I meet them on the street sometimes, and I do feel rewarded by serving a community when I didn't, when I was in the big ivory tower in central London. So my experience, I guess, is yours. If I put you in a practice of 22 people with 35,000 patients, you would probably be utterly miserable. my colleague at the back there was saying about this rational debate and getting people to understand and weigh evidence. I agree completely with what you say about the early conversations, and I agree with both of you about this dialogue, because people haven't, these are really difficult issues, aren't they, that do take a lot of thinking about. And I'll give you the one story that I guess sums it up for me, which I do tell to relatives, which was about my dad, who got diagnosed with 2B myeloma. I mean, he's been dead a long time now. But he was diagnosed with 2B myeloma. And his median life expectancy with the disease state he'd got and the capuchin count he'd got was reckoned to be between 9 months and a year. And my younger sister, who was the nurse, my elder sister is not, were talking about it. My father had always called pneumonia the old man's friend and said if it came along, he didn't want antibiotics. And I was talking to my sister about it and said, well, what happens if it suddenly hits him then? That's what he always said. But if he gets pneumonia this winter and he's debating about the antibiotics, what are we going to say to him? And we said, well, he'd always said, I'm out of here, no antibiotics, thank you. So we'd probably remind him of what he'd always said. Anyway, 4.5 years on, when he's still alive, I was talking to my sister saying, just as well he didn't get that pneumonia, isn't it? Because we'd have seed him off and he'd have had 4.5 more years. The next 8 months was so utterly and unspeakably awful, with wedge fractures, severe pain, hospital admissions recurrently, even for pain relief. And the best thing that happened was the hospice care at the end. But it was so horribly ugly. Was it really worth 4.5 years? Now, almost in my view, not. What about if he'd done 4.5 years and dropped down dead suddenly of a stroke? That would have been probably quite good then, wouldn't it? It's not that easy, but people need to have had those sorts of nuanced conversations to reach a conclusion. And I've thought about it long enough to know exactly where I stand on that issue, which you might have guessed would involve morphine, not antibiotics. But that is a personal view. It's not that everyone has to make the same one, but at the moment everyone is saying, it's only a chest infection, doc, in with the antibiotics. And furthermore, they won't want to reflect back at the end of it. Very rarely patients say to us, I wish I'd listened to you. I wish I'd listened to you about my mum. But very rarely, because you're locked into the guilt then of going, look what I did to my mum. Well, these are personal views, and I'm not a natural manager or a leader. My wife is brilliant at this stuff, and I'm not. So I guess all I can give you is the observations of the people I've seen. I, in some occasions, like benign autocrats. I think sometimes when there's a crisis, you need someone who is beneficent and well-intentioned, who just makes decisions and doesn't run it through 53 committees and a chain of command and a reporting group and work streams and vertical silos and anything else that might want to be put into the management structure. Sometimes you just need someone who makes decisions. So I was a diver before I did medicine, and I worked on a wreck called the Mary Rose. That was raised by the willpower of one person called Margaret Rule. And she decided, she just made decisions. She employed great people to work with, but she decided and things happened. She made some catastrophic errors. Things sank, bits broke, because she was made decisions about things she was wholly unqualified to decide about. But the thing would never have come up without her. So occasionally, benign autocrats are good. I think, I quite like charismatic leaders. I think we all do. That's why they're charismatic, I suppose, isn't it? But I like people who are people. I had a chief executive previously who was utterly fantastic. If you went to see him, he knew who you were. When we moved the intensive care unit, he arrived in his shirt sleeves with a box of coffee. And I know what the trick was. He'd got the staff list out, looked every photograph, and memorized every photograph of every single nurse and their name. But it was a good trick. When he came in, he was able to say, Sally, lovely to meet you. I know it's going to be a busy day. Would you like a cup of coffee? That sort of thing really shows that you have some respect for other people. The other thing I guess I've started playing with a little bit is passing it to my juniors. And that's the one thing I found has been immensely successful. So I did a ward round, hadn't been on the unit for a while. Junior doctor gave the most spectacular handover. And I said to him afterwards, that was absolutely brilliant, you know, spot on, brilliant work. And everyone else in the room sort of wet themselves laughing. And I said, well, I've obviously missed the joke. What's the story? And they said, well, Sam's, this is his last shift. He's off. He's leaving. So I took him aside and said, what on earth are you doing? He said, I can't make a difference in medicine doing this. I'm just, all I do is sit at a computer. I don't see patients. It's just awful. So I've got a job as a management consultant. I'm taken on by McKinsey's. And I said, why on earth are you doing that? He said, well, I want to make a difference in healthcare, but I reckon I might do it that way. I said, well, do you really want to work for a management consultancy? He said, no, I don't, but I want to make a difference. So very enlightened CFO, we're in debt, but I went to see the CFO and I said, this guy's got the nerve to want to make a difference. I'll give him half a salary clinically to work on the ITU. If you'll give him the half for service transformation, and at the end of a year, if he's done nothing, you can sack him and you have lost 30 grand. And he saved the trust £500,000 in his first 5 weeks. So putting the junior people, I suppose that's the wrong phrase too, putting people who aren't old is probably the right way. My old prof used to say people should be professors by the time they're 25, because by the time they're 40, they're burning out. And he's probably right. You want to take the people who, and give them the authority, I think, to make decisions and make a difference. And if they ruin it, let them hang by it. So I'm doing a lot more of that, actually. We're trying to expand that at the moment, to take, not just give it to everybody, but the people who really have the passion to want to drive a difference. Because very often it's that junior nurse or the ward clerk or the whatever it's like that sees where the system doesn't work but hasn't got the power to fix it.
Yeah, I think some of the audience actually said that it's everybody's responsibility to lead and help fix it. The only problem is that within healthcare that isn't so easy.
Yeah, and there's an old saying that was used in the military a fair bit, which was, you know, don't bring me a problem, bring me a solution. So, again, I'll try and do that for my juniors. Say, don't come and whinge to me about stuff. Oh, by all means whinge to me, but put it in writing so I've got something to act on. But better still, come up to me and say, this doesn't work, and I think there are three ways you could fix it, and that's the one I'd go for if I were you. Because it forces me to make a decision then.
Participation. Okay, any other questions? No? Just to thank you.
Well, thank you
enormously
for coming.
For
2 hours, so thank you very much.